Well, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak to the seminar. So this is the first time I'm going to speak about this topic, and I would welcome all kinds of constructive comments, negative or positive. Yes. So first, let me tell you what the talk is about. So the objective of the talk is to describe the geometry of a smooth canonically polarized surface defined over an algebraically closed field of characteristic 2. That has the property that the automorphism scheme of X is not smooth. So equivalently, this is to say that X possesses non-trivial global vector fields. And I will give some numerical conditions that guarantee that the automorphism scheme is actually smooth. Now, this is a situation that appears only in positive characteristic. The reason that it appears only in positive characteristic is that the automorphism scheme is a group scheme and all group schemes are smooth in characteristic 0. But that's not true anymore in positive characteristic. So let me describe the basic steps of the talk. So the first thing I would like to talk about is the motivation for studying this problem and why I think it is significant. The second part will be background and known results on the problem. Then I will state the main theorems and their consequences. Then I will give a short description and the basic steps of the proof. And finally, if time permits, I would like to construct some examples when actually the automorphism scheme is not smooth that show how the subject works. Okay, so this is how the talk will go. So first, motivation. I would like to spend some time to explain why I think this problem is important to study and why I studied it. So my main motivation is the moduli of canonically polarized surfaces in positive characteristics. So let me be a little bit vague and philosophical about the problem. So when a scientist of any kind studies any kind of phenomenon, what does he want? His ultimate objective is to find the laws that govern this phenomenon and, if possible, to find some kind of universal law that governs all phenomena seemingly unrelated. So we are mathematicians and in particular algebraic geometers, and we deal with varieties. So we would like to classify them. One of the fundamental classification questions is to classify varieties up to isomorphism. So what does one do? So start with some class of varieties. And then we ask, is there some kind of universal law that describes the structure of these varieties? Which is to say that, is there some kind of family? So that all varieties in this family, in this class, are fibers of this family, and any other family is obtained from this bi-base change. So this is the universal law that one looks for. So in order to study this problem, what does someone do? So one constructs some functor. So the functor starts from schemes over K, which may perhaps the field that one wants to work. And then it goes to sets, where it sends any scheme to isomorphism classes of families over F, families of objects in C. And perhaps one puts some extra conditions to make the problem more reasonable. And then one asks, is the functor representable? So if the answer was yes, then it means that there is such a universal law. Unfortunately, the answer is rarely yes, so mostly no. So does this mean that there is no universal law? Well, perhaps it just means that we do not understand what it means equivalent. But anyway, the answer is no, and the reason is the existence of non-trivial automorphisms. So one has to compromise. Either change completely his view of the problem, or has to somehow compromise. And there are two ways to compromise. So option one. So forget the family, keep the one-to-one correspondence with the base, and you get a coarse moduli space. But in this case, all information about families is more or less lost. The option two is to insist somehow to have some information about families. So after all, the local deformation functors are quite nice and they are understandable. So one looks for something called modular families. Now, modular family is quite old terminology due to Mumford. Now, the current terminology is stack. But this is more descriptive of what someone is looking for. So what is a modular family? It is a family so that the base, every actually variety is a fiber over the base, and there are finitely many of them. Any family up to a tal-based change is obtained in this way. And moreover, if one picks a point and considers the local ring, the completion of the local ring, together with the family that gets over this completion, this actually pro-represents the local deformation function. So the modular family, of course, you do not get, there's a lot of information about the structure of the families, but it is a kind of bridge between the local deformation, the formal deformation, and the global geometry. So this is a bridge between formal local deformations, something that works quite well, and the global geometry. So basically, it is something that relates global and local. No, this is a very general discussion. I did not say that it exists. Yes. At the moment, this is a really general. Of course, I don't say that such a thing exists or such a thing exists. In the case of this, everything is true. But this is really very general. Now we can specialize. So in my opinion, this subject is really very important because the local situation is understood quite well. The global is not, but that is a bridge between the two. Now let's consider now this particular case. Suppose now that f is actually the functor of a canonically polarized surface. What is known about this functor? So let's say here is characteristic zero. Here's a positive characteristic. Now, what is known is that if one considers the corresponding moduli stack, let's say moduli stack. It has the following properties in characteristic zero. It is a finite type. It is separated. It is Deligne-Mumford. So that means there is a modular family. And if one also add stable surfaces, then it becomes proper. Plus now the Deligne-Mumford property is exactly the existence of the modular family. Now what happens in positive characteristic? The finite type, it is okay. It follows from boundedness theorem due to Matsuzaka, Kolar, and Alexeyev. Separated is also not a problem. Now the Deligne-Mumford is in general no. And the properness, it is, I don't know, one has to know semi-stable reduction in positive characteristic and minimal model program, which is not known to exist. Now, why is the answer here no? The answer is no, because in positive characteristic, there are surfaces with non-smooth automorphism scheme. So why not the Deligne-Mumford in characteristic be bigger than zero? Because there exist smooth surfaces with automorphism scheme, not smooth. And since it is known that the automorphism scheme is finite, not reduced, it is the same thing. So this is why I think it is significant that one studies the automorphism scheme. Of course, it is a fundamental invariant, but the fact being or not being smooth, it is an obstruction to be or not to be Deligne-Mumford. And Deligne-Mumford is important because it is the bridge between local and global. And so if one looks to positive characteristics, one could allow purely inseparable base changes, but then you lose completely the local information. So what can someone do in such a case? How can such a problem be resolved? One possibility is the following. No characteristics, yes. But soon I will explain some. There are restrictions between the characteristic and certain invariants of the surface. So how can this be resolved? How to overcome this complication? So one way to try to overcome this and put some sort of partial order in positive characteristic is to identify the largest possible class of canonically polarized surfaces, which is stable under deformation and specialization. In which class the automorphism is smooth. So such a class behaves exactly like characteristic zero, so it will be Deligne-Mumford. If it's stable under specialization, one also can hope to make proper stacks. And so, of course, this is not possible for all surfaces X. But one can ask, so if it's not possible for all X, then why should you try to do it? Of course, then one can say that if I cannot find the general formula for an equation of degree n, why should I try to solve degree 2 or 3? But people spent a lot of years trying to do it, and it's quite useful. Now, one might think that, let's say, one condition should be just smooth automorphism scheme. But smooth automorphism scheme is not stable under specialization. For instance, one can easily write some family, like, let's say, x0 to be the following quintic, singular. So this is a quintic in P5, let's say characteristic 2. Q? YQ? Z, W. Ah, here. 4. Yes. 3, in fact. It's a surface, yes. Yes. Well, this is, it has A1 type singularities. It's singular, it is canonically polarized with A1 singularities. But it is, the automorphism scheme is not smooth. Why is it not smooth? Because, in fact, it has a non-trivial global vector field. If one considers the global the homogeneous derivation given by W dDW, this is a vector field in P3. It has the property d square is zero, but it preserves x0. So it gives a non-trivial vector field on x0. So this is something that has non-trivial automorphism scheme, but this is smoothable. And one can construct smoothing the following. Take 1 minus t, just the equation. y^5 zw. So that is a family. The general fiber is a smooth hypersurface. Smooth hypersurfaces do not have vector fields. So that is the theorem of Matsumura and Tort. And so that is an example that shows that this the property. There is no t. For t is zero, then it, this is the x0. Ah, it's not a t. I'm sorry. It's a plus twice. 2 plus. Yes. So that is not a good property. It's not stable. Okay. And so this is the reason that I started working in this problem, to investigate the automorphism scheme in positive characteristics, to see when is it non-smooth, and if it is possible to find conditions that guarantee its smoothness. So one can consider corresponding stacks. This is AP, actually, yeah, but it is equivalent to the existence of such actions. Okay, so now let me talk now about the background of this problem and some known results. So actually, there is basically no background. In this form, I am not aware if there have been any previous works, but the following is related to it. So in Rudakov and Safarevich, studied K3 vector fields on K3 surfaces. So in 1976, they showed that any a smooth K3 surface over any field of characteristic P does not have vector fields. So let's say K3 surfaces have no global vector fields. So that is implies that in fact K3 surfaces are all liftable to characteristic zero, and they are unobstructed. They have unobstructed deformations. Then there have been a few examples of surfaces with of canonically polarized surface of general type with non smooth automorphism schemes. And the examples are not many. Initially, I think the first was by Reynaud and Kurke. And then Lang gave, William Lang, not Serge Lang, gave a few examples more, and Shepard Baron in characteristic 2. In this case, characteristic 2. And finally, Matsumura and Oort studied the case of hypersurfaces. And that is in the 60s. And they showed that smooth hypersurfaces in PN D bigger than n plus 1 have no vector fields, no global vector fields. As far as I know, this is kind of background to the subject. Plus, Mumford worked on the Picard scheme, and he examined when the Picard scheme is not reduced. So it's not the same, but it is somehow related. So Mumford, in the 60s, I guess, studied the non-reducedness or non-smoothness. Of the Picard scheme. And then he concluded that the reason that the Picard scheme is non-reduced is because certain operators between first and second cohomology group exist, which he called the box time operators. So, more or less, this is what I know to exist so far. Now, let me state what results I have obtained in characteristic 2. So why characteristic 2? So there are certain advantages and disadvantages of characteristic 2, which I will explain later, but it is a kind of test case to consider the general characteristic. Now, the first thing I would like to mention is that it's relatively easy to find some class that has smooth automorphism scheme. It is the class of any kind of variety, the smooth variety that lifts to characteristic 0. So, it's kind of cheap, but in some sort of accident. So let X be a smooth canonically polarized surface defined over an algebraically closed field of characteristic P. Such that X lifts not necessarily to characteristic 0, but to the ring W to K, the second order bit vector over K. Then the automorphism scheme is smooth. So this is really an accident. Why it is an accident? Because it depends on the Kodaira-Nakano-Vanishing theorem. And whenever some variety lifts to the second bit vector, then Kodaira-Nakano-Vanishing holds together with the Kodaira itself. And it's really just a consequence of this. But it is an accident because it. The smoothness of the automorphism scheme is not related to vanishing theorem. It is some sort of deeper property. And it's not true for singular varieties also. If it is singular, like there is an example, this is singular. It lifts to characteristic zero, but it is the automorphism is not smooth. So it's really an accident, but one can use it to prove many things, like smooth hypersurfaces in P3. All have a smooth automorphism scheme. Now, the next theorem, well, this has some more significant, I think, it is the following. Let f of x be any numerical polynomial then there exist numbers m capital depending only on the coefficients of f. Only on f with the following property, such that let x be a canonically polarized surface defined over a field, algebraically closed field of characteristic p. With Hilbert polynomial f of x. Then, the order of the automorphism scheme, actually not the order, the length, it's not reduced. So. Is less or equal than m. And second, if p is bigger than small m, then the automorphism scheme is smooth. So basically, what does it say? It says that the length of the automorphism is bounded, and if the characteristic is big relatively to the numerical invariants of the surface, then one expects to have a smooth automorphism scheme. So if one fixes some characteristic, then what is the best place to look for surfaces with smooth automorphism? Surfaces with small invariants. So that is the reason characteristic 2 is bad. 2 is very small, so the geometry becomes rather complicated. But it has also some advantage. So this is the actual significance of this theorem that says that for p relatively large compared to, for example, C1 squared, C2 and Euler characteristic, then one expects to have smoothness of the automorphism scheme. And of course, one can ask several problems here, for instance, to find some bound, an effective bound. Find effective bounds for them. So in characteristic 0, there are such results. For instance, Zhao had some results about bounds of the length of the automorphism scheme, but not in positive characteristic. And second, to find, so in fact, this theorem implies that there is some sort of numerical relation between the characteristic and certain invariants. But if they are satisfied, the automorphism is smooth. Let us find numerical relations between P and numerical invariants of x, like say C1 squared, C2, geometric genus, for instance, and Euler characteristic, such that the automorphism will be smooth. So in fact, this is what I'm mostly investigate to find such relation. So in the next theorem that I will write down, it is in this context, in characteristic 2. So far it was in any characteristic. Okay.
Yes.
Everything is nice for curves. The curves don't have. Of course, a curve of genus bigger than 2 does not have any global vector fields because. What is this? This is exactly. What is 0? So it's completely trivial for curves. It's not exactly the same. There are some very old results about the usual bound 84 times 1 minus g does not hold for all characteristics, but there are some works. I do not remember exactly the names of the people who did, but there are. Those are quite old results from the 60s. But for surfaces, there is nothing. In characteristic 0, one knows something like this. 42 squared. This is the bound. But one studies the quotient by the automorphism group, which in characteristic P becomes purely inseparable, and that's difficult to study. But for curves, everything is fine. Now, let's see what happens in characteristic 2. So, let's say here P is 2. And so, let X be a smooth. Canonically polarized surface defined over an algebraically closed field of characteristic 2. And suppose that the automorphism scheme is not smooth. Then, one of the following happens. So, either kx squared is at least 3, so in this case, I don't know what really happens. Or kx squared is 2, and x is uniruled. Moreover, if the Euler characteristic is at most 2, then it is unirational and simply connected. The algebraic fundamental group is trivial. Last case is that kx squared is 1. The geometric genus is at most 1. X is unirational. And simply connected. So in both cases 2 and 3, x is the quotient of some uniruled surface by a rational vector field. Sorry, can you repeat the question?
So he's asking, unirational surfaces, they can be of general type in characteristic.
Yes, it's quite easy. But because the problem that there exists, it is unirational, but the cover is inseparable. So once you have inseparable cover, a lot of things can change. The Kondaira dimension can change. The example that I would like to give at the end is how to construct actually a unirational of general type with vector velocity. And non, it is quite common phenomenon in positive characteristics. Yes? That's not true. In fact, there are examples that are not unirational. But all these examples are in characteristic 2. It is not known a single non-unirational example in characteristic bigger than 2. Yes, so that is another problem. If one can find non-uniruled, basically, in higher characteristics. But in characteristic 2, one can easily write down lots of it. To classify... Well, it's not even clear that such things exist, to tell you the truth. That is a problem. It's not easy to find examples, especially examples with low invariants. With high invariants, one can find lots of kinds of things, unirational, non-unirational, at least in characteristic 2. So there is no hope to do something for high characteristic. But as I said earlier, when the invariants are small compared to the characteristic, here is 2. So these are the cases that are really possible to find something reasonable in characteristic 2. The small invariants, 1 and 2. Perhaps it's possible in 3. But it's much harder. But as the K square increases, then it becomes more and more complicated. Well, for instance, look here, this is the case of Godot surface. Godot is in here, in the last case. So if, let me see, make some sort of comments about this condition, how restrictive these conditions are. Let me say how restrictive these are. Of course, the uniruledness and unirational is very restrictive. It's it does not happen in characteristic 0, but the numerical conditions, for instance. So if kx squared is 1, which is a kind of classical case, so what someone knows, then one knows that the Euler characteristic in this case is between 1 and 3. And the geometric genus is at most 2. And the order of the fundamental group is at most 6. So that's in all characteristics. And so if the Euler characteristic is 1, then we have Godot. The Godot surface is a classical object of study. If the characteristic 0, one distinguishes them with respect to the fundamental group. So if P is 0, then what does one know about the possible fundamental group of Godot? It is, can be either 0, the trivial. It is either Z to Z. So all these cases are possible and there is nothing else. So this is what happens in characteristic 0. All of these cases appear. These are exactly the case of Godot. Not all are classified. These cases are kind of classical cases, and it was Planck that in all characteristics different than 5, these are a quotient of a smooth quintic surface by an action of Z5. All, but a general one, not all of them. So you see, very few actually of them appear in the theorem. So it has to be at least simply connected. So all the other cases are excluded. For instance, the case of classical Godot. Classical Godot, even in characteristic theorem of Planck, a general one, is a quotient of a smooth surface by smooth quintic by Z5. And so, Planck, for a general one, one can show that there are no vector fields because one can move, it's an et al. Cover. But it was not known that it is true for all, but this says that it is for all. No Godot surface with a fundamental group Z5 has vector fields, so it has. And so the rest also. So So in this case, actually, it is a problem. So this is the question. What about simply connected Godot surfaces? Are there any simply connected Godot surfaces that have vector fields? So there are, until a few years ago, it was not even known if simply connected Godot surfaces exist. But it was proved by Lee and Nakayama that